Hey there, and welcome back to the Deep Dive. Today we're diving into how to figure out what customers really want, like really want, not just, kind of sort of want.
It's about building those products and services that people crave. And we have the perfect guide for this, value proposition design.
And I have to say, this book is packed with some seriously insightful stuff. It's like they cracked the code on customer desires.
What I love about this book is that it gives us a framework, a sort of strategic playbook, if you will. It's called the Value Proposition Canvas, and it's all about getting into the mind of your customer.
Okay, so no more shots in the dark, right? We're going to have a systematic way to figure out what makes people tick. Tell me more about this whole value proposition canvas thing.
So imagine this. Instead of just guessing what customers want, we're systematically mapping out their world. We're talking about their jobs to be done, the pains they face, and the gains they're looking for. It's like creating a customer compass.
I like that, a customer compass. So let's break this down a bit. Let's start with jobs to be done. What exactly does that mean?
So a job to be done goes beyond just the functional task someone's trying to accomplish. It digs into the underlying motivation, the why behind their actions.
Okay, I'm intrigued. The book gave this really interesting example about business book readers. You'd think their job is simply reading, but it's so much deeper than that, isn't it?
Exactly. Just reading the book is almost beside the point. Their real job is to use that knowledge to improve their work, to get ahead in their careers, maybe even to impress their boss with a killer new strategy they learned.
Okay, now those are some relatable jobs. So it's not about the book itself, it's about the bigger goal they're hoping to achieve by reading it.
Right. And that's where those pains come in. For a business book reader, it might be the fear of falling behind in their field, or the frustration of ideas not panning out, or maybe they struggle to apply what they've learned in a practical way.
Those are real struggles, for sure. It makes those gains sound even sweeter.
Absolutely. We're talking about things like landing that promotion, seeing their ideas take off, getting recognition for their hard work. Those are the wins that really get them going.
Okay, I'm starting to see the bigger picture here. But how do we take this understanding of jobs, pains, and gains and turn it into, actually creating something people want?
Well, that's where the value map comes in. It's like taking your product or service and asking, does this actually solve my customer's biggest problems? Does it help them achieve those gains they're after?
So it's about finding that sweet spot where what you offer aligns perfectly with what they're craving, like a perfect fit.
Precisely. And you'd be surprised at how even small tweaks, like adding interactive exercises to that business book, can make a world of difference.
Small tweaks, big impact. Speaking of impact, that story about Azuri in the book was really something else. For those who haven't read it, they started with this amazing low-cost solar technology for rural Africa. Amazing idea, right? But things didn't exactly go according to plan, did they?
What's fascinating about Azuri is that they had this fantastic solution, this really innovative solar power technology, but they initially missed a crucial element of the customer's context.
Which was.
Affordability. They had the answer to affordable lighting, but hadn't fully grasped the limitations of their target customer's buying power.
So even with the best of intentions, overlooking that crucial customer insight can really set you back.
Absolutely. But here's where Rory's story takes a turn. Instead of giving up, they took a step back and really tried to understand their customers' jobs. They realized it wasn't simply about owning solar panels, but about having access to affordable, reliable lighting without needing a huge chunk of cash up front.
And that's when the light bulb went off, so to speak.
You could say that. That's when they landed on this ingenious solar as a service model.
Okay, so tell me more about this solar as a service model. Sounds like they really hit on something there.
Instead of requiring customers to pay a large sum up front, they shifted to a pay-as-you-go system. They used prepaid cards, kind of like the ones you'd use for a mobile phone.
That's brilliant. It addressed the job head on,
Right,
right?
yeah.
It tackled that pain of affordability while still delivering on the gain of reliable electricity.
It was a game changer, and it highlights just how powerful it can be when we take the time to truly understand our customers' needs. But there's always that little voice, right? The one that asks, "What if nobody wants what I'm creating?"
Oh, I know that voice all too well. It's the voice of self-doubt whispering in your ear.
And that's precisely where testing comes into play. Think of it as taking your idea for a test drive before going full speed ahead. And the great thing is, value proposition design is full of different methods for doing just that.
So instead of just hoping for the best, we can actually gather evidence and validate our assumptions. I like it. I like it a lot.
Exactly. And there's a whole range of approaches. The book talks about everything from simple landing pages to more elaborate mock sales, all designed to provide valuable insight. It's about being strategic and getting that crucial feedback early on.
Okay, now you've piqued my interest with these mock sales. That sounds intriguing. Tell me more.
So it's about creating a scenario where customers think they're making a real purchase. Maybe it's a pre-order or a limited time offer.
Oh, I see. So you can see how they respond when they think it's the real deal.
Exactly. It's like the ultimate test. Are they actually willing to part with their hard-earned cash for what you're offering?
That's a good point. And of course, you can gather so much from their reactions and feedback during that process, right?
Exactly. It's about gathering a 360-degree view of your target audience, whether that's through customer interviews, analyzing their online behavior, or yes, those mock sales. It's like becoming a detective of customer desires.
A detective of customer desires. I love it. I'm ready to grab my magnifying glass and get to work. But this whole process of testing and iterating, it almost feels like, well, like admitting you don't have all the answers.
And that's the beauty of it. Value proposition design really encourages us to embrace that, to view those bumps in the road, not as setbacks, but as valuable data. Each one is a chance to learn and improve.
It's a real mindset shift, isn't it? From fearing failure to embracing it as a stepping stone.
Absolutely. It's about adopting a test and learn mentality, constantly experimenting, gathering feedback, and refining our offering based on what we discover.
And I imagine that approach keeps things exciting too, right? There's always something new to discover. Speaking of discovering, there's a concept in the book I'm really curious to unpack. The environment map. It sounds like we're charting unknown territories here.
Laughs. In a way, we are. The environment map is all about understanding those external factors that might influence your success, but which are outside your immediate control. Things like industry trends, what your competitors are doing, even technological advancements.
So it's about zooming out and looking at the bigger picture, because our value proposition doesn't exist in a vacuum, right?
Precisely. Ignoring those external factors is like setting sail without checking the weather forecast. You might have a fantastic ship, but you're still at the mercy of the elements.
Now, that's a powerful analogy. And speaking of powerful tools, the book mentions something called the strategy canvas. Is this where we get to unleash our inner strategists?
You got it. The strategy canvas is where we size up the competition. How does our value proposition stack up against everyone else vying for our customers' attention?
So we're not just aiming to be good. We want to stand out from the crowd.
Exactly. It's about identifying your unique strengths, those elements of your value proposition that really set you apart and give you a competitive edge.
It's about finding that secret sauce, that special something that makes you irresistible to your target customer.
Exactly. And you know, one thing the book really emphasizes is that this whole process from understanding your customer to mapping the environment and analyzing the competition, it's not a one-time thing.
It's not a set it and forget it kind of deal, yeah. Right?
Not at all. It's about constantly evolving and adapting. The market changes, your customers' needs change, and you need to be ready to adapt with them.
So it's a journey, not a destination.
Exactly. And like any good journey, there are bound to be some detours and unexpected turns along the way.
That sounds like a great place to pause for now. So we left off talking about how this whole process of understanding and meeting customer needs is an ongoing journey. But before we get too overwhelmed, let's get back to those testing methods. You were about to tell me more about mock sales. I have to admit, the idea both intrigues me and makes me a little nervous.
Well, it's understandable to feel that way, but honestly, mock sales can be incredibly valuable. Essentially, it's like a dress rehearsal for the real deal. Imagine you've got your product or service ready to go. You've put together a web page, maybe even a sales script. Now, instead of just launching it into the world, you create a scenario where a small group of your target customers think they're making a real purchase.
So maybe it's a pre-order, or they think they're getting exclusive early access.
Exactly. Something that makes it feel real, like they're actually pulling out their wallets.
That's a great way to gauge their true interest. Are they actually willing to part with their hard-earned cash for what you're offering? Words are one thing, but actions speak louder.
Absolutely. And the beauty of a mock sale is that it's not just about whether they say yes or no. You can observe their reactions, listen to their questions and hesitations. It's a gold mine of information.
I can see that. You're basically getting a sneak peek into how people might respond when your product or service actually hits the market.
Precisely. And of course, there are other testing methods too. Customer interviews are incredibly valuable. Those one-on-one conversations where you can really dig into their needs and perceptions.
There's something so powerful about those direct interactions.
Absolutely. And these days, with the amount of data available online, you can also learn so much by analyzing how people are behaving. What are they searching for? What are they clicking on? It's all valuable data.
It's like we've become detectives of customer desires, gathering clues from all these different sources to piece together what truly matters to them.
I like that, detectives of customer desires. We need to get that printed on a business card. But speaking of desires, the book also digs into another important aspect of value proposition design, considering the needs of all stakeholders, not just the end customer.
That's an important point. Sometimes we can get so laser focused on the end user that we forget about everyone else involved.
It's easy to do, especially when you're passionate about solving a particular problem for a specific customer group. But if you ignore those other stakeholders, you're missing a big part of the picture. Think about a B2B context, for example.
You might have multiple decision makers, influencers, even end users who interact with the product or service in different ways.
Exactly. And each one of them has their own set of jobs to be done, their own pains and gains. What motivates the CEO to sign off on a purchase might be very different from what matters to the team using the product on a daily basis.
So it's about finding that sweet spot where you're creating value for everyone involved.
It's like solving a multidimensional puzzle. And the good news is value proposition design gives us the tools to do that. They even talk about creating separate value proposition canvases for each stakeholder group.
Now that's an interesting idea, mapping out the needs of each stakeholder in detail.
Exactly. Because, let's face it, if you can't get buy-in from all the key players, your value proposition, no matter how brilliant, is likely to fall flat. But creating a compelling value proposition is only half the battle, isn't it? We also need to find the right business model to support it.
That's a really good point. Even the best idea in the world needs a solid foundation to thrive.
Absolutely. A great business model is like the engine that powers your value proposition. It's about figuring out how you'll deliver that value in a way that makes sense, both for your customers and for your business.
And that can be tricky, right? Finding that balance between creating something people love and making sure it's sustainable in the long run.
It's a balancing act, for sure. But value proposition design offers some great guidance here. They even provide 7 key questions to ask yourself when evaluating different business models.
7 questions to unlock business model clarity. I'm all ears.
Things like understanding your revenue streams. Will it be a one-time purchase? Or are you looking at a subscription model? How much will it cost to acquire a new customer? And how easily can customers switch to a competitor?
These are all crucial considerations, and they highlight how important it is to think about the business side of things right from the start.
100%. And, you know, the book gives this great example of a company that's really mastered this delicate dance between value proposition and business model. Have you heard of Taobao? They're huge in e-commerce, especially in China.
The name rings a bell, but I'm not overly familiar with them. Tell me more.
Well, Taobao's story is a fantastic example of a company that's constantly evolving and adapting. When they first launched, they were essentially an online marketplace connecting buyers and sellers. Pretty straightforward. But then they noticed something interesting happening.
What was that?
They saw this massive influx of small-scale entrepreneurs using the platform to sell their goods. These weren't big companies. These were individuals, often working from home, selling everything from handmade crafts to vintage clothing.
So they tapped into this whole wave of micro-entrepreneurship. That's interesting.
And here's the thing. Instead of just letting it happen, Taobao decided to actively support these entrepreneurs. They realized that the more successful these small businesses were, the more successful Taobao would be. So they created all sorts of tools and resources specifically designed to help these micro-entrepreneurs thrive.
What kinds of tools?
Things like training programs, payment solutions, even marketing support. They basically created an entire ecosystem to help these businesses grow.
Now that's smart. It's a win-win.
It was a stroke of genius. But they didn't stop there. As Taobao grew, they noticed a shift in customer preferences. People were becoming more discerning, looking for higher quality goods, often from established brands.
So they had to adapt again.
Exactly. And that's precisely what they did. They launched Tmall, a new platform specifically geared towards larger brands and a more premium shopping experience.
They were basically playing chess, always thinking a few moves ahead. But that kind of constant evolution, that willingness to adapt, it takes a certain mindset, doesn't it? You have to be comfortable with change.
Absolutely. And I think that's something that value proposition design really emphasizes. The business world is in constant flux. Customer needs change. Competitors emerge. Technology disrupts. You can't just create a value proposition and assume it'll be relevant forever. You need to be willing to adapt, to iterate, to embrace that constant state of evolution.
So it's not about finding the perfect answer. It's about being flexible and responsive to the ever-changing landscape.
Exactly. And often that evolution happens best when it's a collaborative effort. The book talks a lot about the importance of aligning your entire organization around your value proposition.
That makes sense. It can't just be one department's responsibility, right?
Right. Getting everyone on the same page, working towards a shared vision of value creation, that's when the magic really happens. And a tool like the Value Proposition Canvas can be really helpful for that.
How so?
Well, by visualizing those customer jobs to be done, their pains and gains, it creates a shared language that everyone in the organization can understand, from the product development team to the marketing department to the customer service reps on the front lines.
It's about creating that shared understanding, that sense of purpose that everyone can get behind.
Exactly. And when you can achieve that, that's when you start to see something really special emerge.
It's like you're creating a company culture where everyone's speaking the same language, the language of customer value.
Exactly. And when that happens, everyone benefits. Your team is more aligned, your customers are happier, and your business is more successful. It's a win-win-win.
And that brings us to the end of our deep dive into value proposition design.
It's been quite a journey, hasn't it? We've covered a lot of ground.
We really have. We talked about the importance of understanding your customers' jobs to be done, their pains, and their gains.
Mm-hmm.
We explore the power of the Value Proposition Canvas and the Value Map. We even touched on the importance of testing your assumptions and finding the right business model.
And we can't forget those real-world examples. Hearing how companies like Azuri and Taobao use these principles to achieve incredible success, it really brings it all to life.
Absolutely. Those stories are so inspiring. So as we wrap up, is there one key takeaway, one golden nugget of wisdom that you hope our listeners will walk away with today?
You know, if there's one thing I hope people take to heart, it's this. Creating something truly valuable is an ongoing process. It's not a one-time event. It's about constantly listening to your customers, adapting to their needs, and being willing to evolve your offering over time.
It's about embracing that journey, even with all its twists and turns.
Exactly. And the great thing is, with tools like the Value Proposition Canvas and the principles outlined in this book, we don't have to navigate that journey alone. We have a roadmap. And that makes all the difference.
So to our listeners out there, whether you're a seasoned entrepreneur or just starting out, I highly encourage you to check out Value Proposition Design. It's a game changer.
I couldn't agree more. Because at the end of the day, understanding your customers and creating value that matters, that's the key to building a business that truly thrives.
And on that note, we'll wrap up this deep dive. Until next time, keep exploring, keep innovating, and keep creating value.